But today, I just feel led to bring a message about faithfulness. And we're going to start here in, we're going to start in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. And it says this: "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. And moreover, it is required in the stewards that they be found faithful." It can be found faithful. Can you imagine dropping your car off at the valet where they do that now? Hospitals do it now for free a lot of times. If you go to a nice restaurant or you go downtown into a city or something, they need to park your car for you. But can you imagine the valet? You know the classic story, right? You hear that squealing in the distance. You know, the car racing around. That better not be my car, you know. Well, you want your valet to be faithful with your car, right? I mean, that's kind of the whole idea. Who would trust their automobile to someone who was not going to be careful with it when they have it, and that someone who wouldn't treat it like it was their own, right? So that's what a steward does. A steward on a ship, if you go on a cruise and you want to leave your valuables instead of in the safe on your ship, if you want to leave that with the ship, then that's their job, is to be in charge of your stuff while you give it into their care. They treat it like it was their own, and they watch out for it, and they take care of it. And that's what a steward is supposed to do. A steward is a manager. A steward is someone who takes care of something that is someone else's. And Jesus gave Paul, and Paul in turn to the churches, this gospel message. He says, we've been good stewards of this gospel message, and now I'm giving it to you also. And he wants them also to be good stewards of this message. In other words, to be faithful with it. And that's what he points out in this passage here, that is required in a steward that he be found faithful. A financial manager, if you have a 401k or its equivalent, and you give them money, your money, you expect a certain amount of them taking care of it for you. If the market starts to tank and your stocks are plummeting, you want them to shift and diversify into something else that looks out for your interest and your money as if it were their own. You see, being a good steward has the number one requirement of faithfulness. Faithfulness, and we've been given a great charge. This gospel message that we have, this good news, that really should be good news to us. And what do I mean by that? What I mean by that is if you are feeling like the weight of Christianity or faith or your ministry or whatever is weighing you down in ways that it should not, there's something wrong. Because Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And so he wants us to handle things even better than that. Now, I'm going to stop just for a moment because I made a mistake. I messed up. I will not let this day go by and fail to recognize someone who's not going to be with us going forward. I just looked over and I saw... Savannah, thank you. Savannah, would you come on up here? And we're going to take a break on this message, so I don't know how that does it with the recording and sound people and all like that. But Savannah, would you come and let us bless you as you go into the army? Would you welcome her up here? Savannah has been with us. Yeah. And thank you for coming on up, and also Mark, if you would come up as well. I just grabbed a couple of Army veterans to come up and also just lay hands on you and bless you as you go. Is that okay? And I just want to do that. But would you pray with us as we send her off? She's been with us and then gone away from us and then back with us and in and out for various moves, but every time she's here, she's with us. And we just want to bless her as she goes. We lose kids sometimes, and I'm sorry to call you a kid, but I'm 53 now. That just happens, all right? Lose kids. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, old man you, right? But we don't want to lose you. We want to send you. And so I just want to pray a blessing on you as we go. Heavenly Father, with these men also, Lord, as we lay hands on our sister, Lord, Savannah, and send her off to write a blank check with her life, Lord, to an honor to serve our country in ways, Lord, that may defend others at home or abroad. Lord, it may require of her everything, the ultimate sacrifice. And Father, we trust that that's not going to happen to her, that you're going to watch over her and send your angels of protection or be around her, Lord. But Father, she makes this awesome write of the check, the willingness to sign up for that open-ended commitment, Lord. We pray a commitment of blessing over her. We will pray for her, that we will bless her, Lord. I pray that as she goes through basic training, God, that you would help her to believe every day, I can do this. I can do this. I will get out of here. This is not a prison forever. I will get to get out of here. Father, as she goes into her training time, Lord, that you would give her grace and understanding of what her job is, Lord, and help her to do it well. And Father, when she goes out into her first permanent duty station, Lord, that you would bless her again, Lord. And I pray that not only would she be able be effective in her ministry, Lord, there of for our country, but that, Lord, you would open a church for her nearby that you have already prepared, Lord, other believers, Lord, who will help keep her strong in their faith and in her commitment to Christ, Lord. And I pray, oh God, that you would just bless her in her future as she goes forward, Lord. And when she comes home, Lord, to bless us, to visit, Lord, to see us from time to time, God, we pray that that would be the case, Lord, that we'd be able to just rejoice with her coming back and celebrate what God's doing in her life. So we pray a blessing over her as we send her in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you, Savannah. Love you. Amen. Sorry for the interruption of the message. That was for a really good reason. Last week I did the same thing and I failed to act on it. I was like, she's leaving this week. We're not going to do that twice. So faithfulness in our service. I want to go next to Luke chapter 16. And Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. It says, it's the parable of the unjust servant. What are we finding here? We're looking for the fact that our time is short, so let us use the remaining time wisely. It says, he also said to his disciples, there was a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. In other words, he wasn't being a faithful servant. He wasn't being a faithful steward. And so he called to him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account for your stewardship, for you can no longer be a steward. Then that steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my master has taken the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I have resolved what to do. When I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. And so he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, 100 measures of oil. So he said to him, take out your bill and sit down and quickly write 50. And he said to another, how much do you owe? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. And so the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of the world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of the light. And he says, he makes a recommendation to the evil persons who were there and said to them, I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, so that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. Jesus said that this world are wiser than this generation of believers when it comes to faithfulness in service. It said even a story about an unfaithful steward, and he was wasting goods, he wasn't doing what he's supposed to do, and ultimately in a way didn't really do the master any favors by getting a cut rate on some of the debts that were owed to him. But on the other hand, he says, I've got an eternity, the rest of my life to worry about. We would apply that to our eternal home. And he would say, what can I do with the time that is left in my service? You see, because all of us, our stewardship will be taken away from us when we die. Now, hopefully we're not being unjust stewards now, but if we are, we have a chance to do something great for our eternal time frame and do it now. Before we run out of life, before we run out of the rest of the days of our life, is there something that we can do now that though it may be shrewd, though it may be catch up, though it may be pushing harder than we would have before, can we still show faithfulness to our servant and to serve others in such a way that we would find favor in heaven? Now, I don't want to make too much of that, but basically what Jesus was saying is, learn from the bad guys. Even they know how to make things, to make a fresh start, to be able to take the time that we have now and do something better. Now, I don't know how faithful you and I have been, and well, I know about my own self, I can't say for you, how faithful or unfaithful as a steward of the things that God has given us. I don't know how faithful we've been, but I do know one thing. If we're going to be weighed on the balance and found lacking, I want to be able to say, is there something I can do now? Now, again, I'm not talking about earning your salvation. I'm talking about people who are already saved. Your salvation is secure. But we've been called to be more than just saved. We've been called to be people who are stewards of the message of the gospel. Is there anything we can do to redeem the time? To be able to actively do something with the rest of my life? You've got to say today in this service, oh God, I have been unfaithful with the beautiful gift of the gospel that you've given me. I have not shared it the way I should. I have not been a servant in the church the way that I should. I haven't been a servant to my fellow man and done things for the kingdom of God that are necessary. But today I want to make up for some lost ground. Today I want to work like this unjust servant who said, I'm going to make a difference today. Interesting story, a little difficult to unpack in there, but to use a borrowed term from Mark, but a little bit hard to unpack, but what a tremendous blessing when you begin to. Now, the chapter goes on in verse 10, it says, Jesus says, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in what is much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, which is money, who will commit to you, to your trust, the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and the God of money, mammon. And so I want to encourage us in our work life, in our school life, in our church life, and in every part of our life, if we are not being faithful in the little things, how can God trust us with the greater things? If we want to ever be in charge of our own stuff, will not receive that blessing from the Lord unless we have first learned to be faithful with another man's stuff. Now, this gets tested at your job. Are you wasting resources of the business because you don't really care, because it's not your money anyway? Are you being faithful? Are you stealing paper clips? Are you stealing, rubber bands or stationery or paper? Are you being faithful in what is another man's? And if so, then God will grant that you should also be blessed and be able to take care of your own stuff. But he says, if you're not faithful in someone else's, how can he give you the real riches of reward? How can he trust you with the greater and more important things? How can he promote you, in other words, whether that be in the church or whether that be in your personal life or at your job? How can we do that unless we are found faithful? I want to encourage you. Probably the most important thing is to be humble. But right after that, humility to say that I will serve Christ, I will serve my boss the way I serve Christ. And I will be faithful to my boss the way I am faithful to Christ. And I will be faithful if I'm my own boss with the money and the care of everyone who is my client. I will be faithful in everything with other man's stuff so that God can bless me with what I have. Because it's required in someone, a steward, that he be found faithful. Next place I want to look and point out is if our time is short, let us use that time wisely. Being faithful. So next, let's just move over a couple of pages to Luke chapter 19. I'm going to look at verses 12 through 26. Therefore, Jesus said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And so he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, and said to them, do business till I come. And so the citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, "We will not have this man to reign over us." If you're trying to find the spiritual application, Jesus is that businessman that's gone away on a trip. And he has committed the business of saving souls and advancing the kingdom of God to his servants. And that's us. That's the Christians. That's us. And the citizens are the people of the earth who are not followers of Christ, who hate him, who are not who are at war with Christ, and are not good people. It says verse 15, "And so it was when he returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to whom he had given the money to be called out to him, that he might know how much money every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, 'Master, your mina has earned 10. Well done, good servant, because you were faithful in very little, have authority over 10 cities.'" So there's the advancement of being faithful. "And the second came, saying, 'Master, your mina has earned 5 minas.' Likewise, he said to him, 'Also, you will be over 5 cities.'" Now notice he didn't say, "Man, you know, that's half of what the other guy did. What is your problem?" Now, we do see a little bit of that later when it gets down to the one, don't we? Isn't it interesting that whether the person had gifts and abilities or drive and ambition that should push himself to be able to take one and turn it into 10, even so the person who had one and turned it into 5 was not diminished, because everybody has their own gifting. Not everybody is as good at finances. Not everybody is put in a neighborhood or a city that can multiply as much. It really depends on the circumstances around you. It depends on the gifting that God has given you. But in both cases, the one who raised 10 and the person who multiplied it into 5 were both praised, because I believe that both of those were doing the best that they can with the resources and time and giftings that God had given them. But boy, it gets to be a whole story with another story with the third one. And then the other one came, verse 20, saying, "Master, here is your mina, which I have kept and put away in a handkerchief, for I feared you, because you are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow." Where did God get that reputation? Where did God get that reputation? Is he not the loving, caring Jesus that we know from the New Testament? I was talking to a Jewish ethnic good friend Christian of mine recently, that I won't name, and we were talking about this very issue. You ask the average modern Jew about the nature of God, and it's going to come across a lot harder, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, kind of a God description, than you're going to get from the average Christian. So the question is, which one of those is true? Is it the eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, kind of a vengeance and wrath and pouring out from violence from heaven on all ungodly people? Is that the God that we serve? Or is it the humble and meek Jesus, the Lamb who was slain, the loving one that we see often portrayed in the New Testament? Which one is God? Would the real God please stand up? Well, both of them are him. Both of them. In fact, the grace that we enjoy in the New Testament, when the punishment of our sins was taken out of the way by the cross, all we get to deal with or have to deal with as far as the justice and judgment of God in the New Testament is the love and relationship that he's starting to want to rebuild in us. That is an awesome, good news message to be able to share. But just because we're saved and going to heaven doesn't mean that we won't give account of ourselves to the judge at the end of time. Now, we will miss out on the great white throne of judgment. If you are a saved believer, you won't have to face the great white throne of judgment where all your sins are judged individually and you are thrown into the lake of fire for your sins. Thank God, because our judgment was placed on Christ at the cross. And when we put our faith in him, he took that judgment for us. But does that mean that we won't ourselves face some kind of judgment? The Bible says, and indeed we will. We call it the Bema Seat of Christ. And though it is more of an award ceremony, there will be a great deal of loss felt at that one as well. And we'll look at that in just a moment. I'm getting ahead of myself. Verse 21, "For I feared you because you are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow." And he said to him, "Out of your own mouth I will judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was an austere man, collecting what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow." In other words, expecting something out of my servants. "Why then did you not put my money in the bank, and at my coming I might have at least collected it with interest?" And he said to those who stood by, "Take the mina from him who gave it to him, take the mina from him and give it to the one who has 10. And they said to him, "Master, he has 10 minas. For I say unto you that to everyone who has will be given, and from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him." There's stuff to be done. There's work to be done. There is opportunities to be able to be a good steward of what we have in this life. And these passages reveal that. But I want to keep moving. Have we wasted God's time and money in worship of self and in worship of ease? Mammon is a funny word that's in the Bible. He talks about there. Mammon's not just another word for money. It is the god of money. And ultimately, it's the god of self. When we worship self and when we worship money, then we put those things ahead of the things of God, and we serve ourselves instead of God. So let's look at this next scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's see, verses 10 and 11. 2 Corinthians 5. Is that right? Yes. "Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him. For we must all appear before," what? "The judgment seat of Christ." Now again, this is not that great white throne of judgment, that fearful one that all unbelievers will be judged at. That's not this one. Thank God. I mean, literally. But also, God says there will be a judgment. Everyone will be judged in some form. We must all, us Christians, appear before the judgment seat of Christ. And so from here, I'm going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 9 through 15, and it begins to talk a little bit about that judgment time. Chapter 3, verses 9 through 15. He says, "Now we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, and you are God's building." So you are God's building? That's what it says, right? You're not your own building. We are God's building. And it says, verse 10, "According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid a foundation of that building, and another builds on it. But let each take heed on how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." So Jesus is the foundation. "Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold or silver or precious stones or wood or straw or hay, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward." Who is this worker he's talking about? Well, it can't be Christ, because Christ himself is the foundation. It can't be Paul, because Paul said he's the one who laid that foundation. So who's building the house? We are the workmen. We are building our own house, brick by brick, or straw by straw, with precious stones or with wasteful things. We're going to end up. Verse 15. "If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire." What an amazing picture of the bonfire of the vanities. Vanity in this, that we would build our life on the foundation of Jesus Christ with things that don't matter. If we would build on our life things that are wood and hay and stubble, he says those things are going to burn up in the judgment of God on that Bema Seat day. But if we brick by brick build in our life the things that are right, the things that are righteous, the things that make you a man or a woman of honor and integrity, that causes you to do the right thing even when no one's noticing, when no one's looking, when you begin to share your faith and be selfless, when you do things for others instead of for yourself, those things are the gold and silver and precious stones. Those are things that fire cannot destroy. Fire cannot destroy metal. Fire cannot destroy gemstones. Fire cannot destroy those precious things that are going to last of value for eternity. The lives of other people that you touched, people who get saved because of your giving to missions, people who get saved because you show up on a Saturday morning and pass out door hangers. Thank you to the three people, including myself, that showed up yesterday. Now, I have learned that you don't shame people about stuff like that, because there's always good reasons for people to be going any given place at any given time. But I do want to say that the Bible says, pray for the Lord of the harvest to send forth more laborers. So I'm praying that the Lord of the harvest would send forth more laborers, and I'm praying that those laborers come out of our own ranks here. Why are we here if we're not doing the Great Commission? Why are we here if we're not doing what Jesus said to do? Because if we're not doing that, then we're not doing anything out of gold or precious stones or silver. And we may esteem it highly. We may look at our wood carving and, like Cain, say, this is a precious and awesome thing that I offer to you, God. And God says, it's going to burn. Is it what I told you to do? But it's comfortable. It's sawdust. It's fluffy. I like it. I like hay. Hay makes me happy. Hay softens my bed. And he says, hey, it's going to burn. I say, Lord, why can't you be happy? Weren't you born in a manger? Don't you like wood and hay and stubble? He's like, hello, it's about people. It's about doing the will of God. It's about the praise of his glory. And those things are the good, the silver and the gold and the precious stones. Those are the things to build your life out of. And whenever all the world lives individually are at that bema seat, it's like they're all going to be piled in one place, both the good and the bad and the ones that are just kind of, wood, hay, and stubble. We see the good isn't going to be weighed against the bad, because the bad has already been taken care of and judged at the cross. So I got news for you. This bonfire of the vanities here is not going to be about your evil works. The pile of evil works that you do in your life are not even going to be judged there, if I understand my theology correctly, because the cross is where they were judged. At the cost of the blood of Christ, that's where my sins were covered. So I'm good then, right? So it's like reward day with my gold, silver, precious stones, and all my evil's been placed on Christ and it's gone, so woohoo, I'm in. Yeah, we get to that part. But there is this thing called Judgment Day. There is this big bonfire. What's all this fire? What's causing this huge flame and flare-up? Oh, that's all my selfishness. That's all my wood and my hay and my stubble. That's the stuff that I built my life out of that was not as important as the things of God. That's when I comforted myself instead of others. That's when I did what I wanted to do instead of what God wanted to do. That's when I worshiped myself instead of him. And God calls us to be more faithful than that. Well, what if we're not? It's all going to burn. And if we're lucky, quote unquote, we're going to have something we can dig through the ashes and find that it's like, well, what about this, God? I found a little something here to offer you. Well, in that case, what's his reaction going to be? Get that out of here. No, he's going to be like, yes! He's going to be up there with us, blown away the ashes, looking for scraps of gold and silver and precious stones, and he's going to be as excited about them as we are. Because he's a good God. Because he loves us. Because he wants the best for us. He's going to be excited about those things. I just don't want to go after Paul. I certainly don't want to set my little stuff there next to his big pile. Look, Paul, look at all the good, awesome things you did. Oh, yeah, there's a little bit of fluff around there, and that's all burned up now. But wow, what gifts you have provided for the kingdom of God to be able to give to your master. And then there's me over here, like, give me a second. Something. God wants us to be more faithful than that, to be able to give more to our master. The time is short. Let us redeem the times. The days are evil. Okay, where are we? 1 Corinthians 3, 9 through 15, that's just what we just did, is that correct? All right. We need to not worship self and ease. As the time of accounting comes, let us be wise with our remaining time and money. So let's look at time for a minute. James chapter 4 and verse 14 says this about our time. I'll just read it off of there. James 4:14, is it coming up? That is next, right? Oh, that's it, yeah. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow, for what is your life? It's even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. So if we're going to worship time, boy, is that fleeting. If we're going to hang on to our time because our time is precious, then that is so short. We either spend that on Christ or we spend it on ourselves. And if you spend it on Christ, it will last forever. Gold, silver, precious stones. But if we spend that fleeting time, that vapor of time that God has given us on this earth, that's all you get. There's your reward. Here's your sign. So we need to be careful about not wasting that vapor of a time that we have for that which vanishes away. Here's another thing that the Bible says about time in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. See then that you walked circumspectly, in other words, looking around, not as fools, but as wise people. Why? Redeeming the time because the days are evil. Redeeming the time, that means buying back every minute you get. We don't really get any extra seconds in the day, do we? We don't really get any minutes in the day that are extra, really, do we? So how can we redeem time? How do we buy back time? By taking the time we have that is delegated to things that are ultimately going to burn and say, that time slot I want to use for God. That time slot is going to be my prayer time in the morning. That time slot is going to be time that I serve at the church vacuuming or cleaning or scrubbing toilets, or as I go out doing door hangers and hanging things, or as I volunteer to do things for the kingdom of God in missions trips and giving. That's how that's going to go. And so we buy back the minutes and seconds of our lives that is fleeting and vaporizing every moment away, and we say, I'm going to buy that back with good works for my Lord and redeem that time, because after all, the days are indeed evil. Who's going to do it if we don't? And so now let me look at money. The Bible has a few things to say about money. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 9 says, honor the Lord with your possessions. Let's let that hang there a minute. How do you honor the Lord with your possessions? I'm going to say this. I don't know. I don't know for you. I would not presume to tell you how to spend your money, because the moment I start getting controlling about how to spend your money, then you no longer have the choice and I become a cult leader. And we don't want that, do we? Which leaves a responsibility on you to be the grown-up who says, I will handle my own money, thank you very much. Good. Good, then honor the Lord with it. Honor the Lord with it. We're capitalists. We're not socialists. Now, there may be some discrepancy in opinion in small circles. Let's not get political. But we like to keep what we have. We don't want to give it all away. But see, communism forces you to give away what you got and makes you give to others, and you have no real say in it. But the generous heart who has and can own all that he works for, or she works for, has the gift of being able to give that away to others. And so the Bible says, honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. What is my increase? My income. The IRS recognizes very well what increase is. If you ever wonder, what is my increase? Let's start with what the IRS says is your increase. Now, God's standards might be all your increase, as opposed to those things that are parsed out and said, okay, that doesn't count because of this, or that's interest, or that's whatever. But God says all your increase. Honor the Lord with all the first fruits of all your increase. I challenge you to write your giving first. I challenge you to make that a tithe, a tenth. Yeah, if you can't do a tenth, you really probably can, and you probably are robbing yourself and God if you don't, but I encourage you to give it a try. But at the very least, whatever your giving is, you give that first to the Lord. And then see if God can help you with the rest. I mean, come on, we're talking faith here and a God who's infinite. So that's what he says about that. Honor the Lord with your giving and your substance. And then let's look at Malachi chapter 3. I used to stay away from Malachi because at first it was overused in the churches, I felt, as I was growing up, about telling people, you've robbed God, give your tithe because otherwise you've robbed God. I was like, and then I found out they're probably right, you know. But here's the difference. In the Old Testament, you rob God, what do you think is going to happen? The judgment of the law comes on you. In the New Testament, if I steal from God, it's forgiven. Woohoo! I don't hear an amen from anybody. If I steal from God, I'm good. I am forgiven. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am completely pure and holy before him because of what Christ did on the cross. Because every time I steal from God, it goes on the cross of Christ, and he got judgment on him, and I am scot-free. Woo! I love being a Christian. Y'all not with me? Because you know where this is going, don't you? Because just because something can be done doesn't mean it should be done. Just because I can steal from God doesn't mean I should steal from God. And though the judgment of the law may not be upon me, the blessing certainly isn't either. All the blessing of the law is for us in the New Testament. All the curse of the law was taken on the cross. What a beautiful story that is. But let us not abuse the grace that has been given to us, being thieves and robbers of God, and then saying, woohoo, I got away with that one. No, let us be people of integrity who give the Lord his, and then believe by faith that he's going to go farther with what we have left than we ever dreamed possible. Malachi chapter 3, verses 7 through 12. Yet from the days of your fathers you have gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you said, In what way shall we return? Next verse. Will a man rob God? And yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse. That's the curse I said. Thank you, Jesus. We are not under anymore. That curse went on the cross. Woohoo! I'm done. We don't have to look at Malachi anymore, do we? I still want to look at Malachi because the good part's the second part. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Verse 10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. In other words, we got to pay the electric bill, folks. Pastor wants a salary. Now, I can go work a secular job, but I'd like to keep my job. I'd like the lights to be paid. I'd like to have air conditioning for us. I'd like to continue to buy printing so that we can continue to reach the community. I'd like to still be able to share with others whenever they have need. I'd like to be able to buy new carpet when it runs out. We would like to continue the work of God in missions. Bring tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Now who wants to take out Malachi? Now who wants to not listen? I want that blessing. I'm going to try God, and I'm going to give my tithes and my offerings, and I'm going to try Him and see if He won't bless me more with my 90% or less than He ever did whenever I was the God of my own money and my own time. I dare you to try Him, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. Anybody got a devourer that's always eating up your income? It's like you got your bills, but you still say, where'd all the money go? It's called the devourer. He says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. If you will give and honor me in your giving and not rob from me, I in turn got your back. I will rebuke the devourer. You may or may not get another flat tire. You may or may not have to pay extra on something. I'm not sure how he's going to rebuke the devourer, but he said he would. For your sake, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all the nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. God is not a slum lord. God is not looking for your money just so he can have it. Here's a newsflash. God doesn't need your money. But this message is about faithfulness. And I am not ashamed to say that if we don't preach all the Word of God, including the faithfulness of our time and our money, then we, the church, are not doing you any favors. But if I tell you the good news that the curse of your robbery is paid for by Christ and my robbery, and the blessing is still yours to be had, then how dare I not tell you about tithing? How dare I not allow you to have the devourery kept away from your door? How dare I not allow you to be blessed like Malachi says? Yeah, it's good stuff. Thanks, Pastor. It's good preaching. All right, Acts chapter 20 is the last one we'll look at. Yes, you yourselves know that these hands have provided for my necessities. This is Paul speaking. He says, unlike Pastor Steve, I, Paul, work for a living and provide by tent making my needs. Now, I can say that boldly because he goes on to say in other places that it is right and good that the ox not be muzzled while he treads out the corn. And how that giving to the full-time ministers is biblical and right and the goal of every church to do. Not every church can do that, so there are bivocational pastors. By the blessings of God and your generosity, we're able to have me as a full-time pastor. But I would work my butt off doing a secular job if the Lord required it, because Paul, my example, says, you've seen these two hands? They've provided for my necessities and for those who are with me, but go on. I have shown you in every way that laboring like this, that you must support the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus where he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. More blessed to give than to receive. Blessed to be faithful in your long-term commitments to Christ than to worship your own time, your own money. God's called us to faithfulness. I've got an extra 6 minutes. Of course, I started 6 minutes early, let's be fair. But would you stand with me so we can make some time of commitment out of this? Because I got a couple of extra minutes, I want to do something I don't normally do. And that is I want to invite you, if God's spoken to your heart about any of this, don't tell, don't say what. But if God's challenging you to some kind of commitment, would you come out of where you're at, come up here, and either kneel at these altars or stand and pray privately. I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing over you, but I'm not going to ask you what you're doing. We're not going to delay this. But if God is dealing with your heart, sometimes walking an aisle and standing there and praying to God up front shows God that you're making a commitment in your heart that maybe is really going to be significant to you, that means something. Now you say, well, I don't know, can I do that where I'm at? Oh, sure. Absolutely you can. I don't want to get into that firefight with you. But sometimes, I know me, and for me, when I was growing up, there was a whole lot of altar time. There was a whole lot of come up and pray and commit to God about things. If God's speaking to your heart about being a faithful, committed servant of His, about being a good steward of your time and your talents, and maybe your treasures as well, if you'd like to make that commitment, would you please make that where you're at? Or up here, if you would feel that that would be some kind of extra gift that you give to God of your humility and your obedience. We're not going to judge each other here, right? Nobody's going to look at each other and see who went and who didn't. We're not going to judge, are we? Can we agree not to judge each other? Amen. All right, good, good, yeah. Well, Heavenly Father, I just pray, Lord, for all of us under the sound of my voice who are making decisions right now of commitment to Christ to be faithful in our service to You, to be faithful with the gospel that has been committed to us, to be faithful to build on the life that You gave us. It's not my life anymore, but the life that You gave me. Would You help me to build on the foundation of Christ, gold and silver and precious stones, the things that are going to last for eternity, the things that are pleasing to You. Would You help me do that, Lord? And Father, if You require anything of me, time, my talents and my abilities, or my treasure, then Lord, I will acknowledge that I died some time back. Because the Scripture says I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, and yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. And so, Lord, this is not my life. This is Your life. These hands are Yours for me to serve in tent making or in service to others or in any way You see fit. These eyes are Yours to look at and read and see the things that are good and noble and just, pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous or praiseworthy. This mind will think on these things and set my eyes on those things. Lord, I've lived a lot of my life already. If I'm lucky, I'll live another 53 years and be 106, and somebody's still going to be paying me Social Security and ripping off the government. I don't know. But Lord, I don't think I got that much time left. Pretty sure, Lord, that the time ahead of me, Lord, is less than the time behind me. So Lord, like that unjust servant who decided to do the best with the time remaining on earth to be able to make a difference that lasts in eternity, so Lord, help me to commit this day that You can have me. You can have my checkbook, have my debit card. You can have my talents. You can have my time. You can have everything that is lying to me and telling me that if I just serve them, that I will be happy. Lord, I know that I will never be happy unless I've committed all that I have to You. Lord, would You just cement this thought in my heart right now? Would You help me to make good on the commitments that I'm making now? And Lord, though I'm only flesh and I might fail, I will resolve to get up again and again and again and take the hours and the minutes and the time and redeem them also for the glory of God. Help me to trust You, Lord. We talk a lot of smack about faith. Lord, help me to live what I believe. These things we pray in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. If you want to continue to pray, you're welcome to, but I am going to bring us to the time of the service where I pray a blessing over you. The blessing that God told Moses to pray over the people of God. And you are the people of God. The law said that there were blessings and cursings. Blessings if you follow the Lord, cursings if you did not follow the law. We've learned that through Christ, all the curse is gone, but the blessing still remains. And so the blessing of Abraham of the Old Testament still applies to you New Testament followers of Christ. And so what a message today about commitment and faithfulness to Him. I want to, and I'm glad to, remind you of the blessing of Abraham that is also yours to inherit as people of faith. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. May He lift up His countenance upon you, and that brings you peace. For you are blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like our Lord?
Nobody.
Then go in His peace today and be faithful to our God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.